Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Yeah, I got a little buzz there. Yeah, what can I say? I think this camera kind of zooms in a little bit. Anyway, I have some people, asking me to do a teaching on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And they're asking me several questions. So I'm trying to make a video to answer you guys, okay? Because, look, for all you guys who are, you know, hardcore Holy Spirit blasphemers, there are tons and tons of people in every denomination who want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and they don't care about the traditions of their denomination. Okay, as a matter of fact, there's a huge amount of Baptists who've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, you know, and the leadership just won't accept it. But thousands and thousands and thousands of Baptists. Matter of fact, I saw some survey before I came to the Philippines. It seems like there's like about 25% of all Baptists who claim they've received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but they just use it in their cell group and their home Bible study. They don't use it in their church because their church won't allow it, even though the Bible says forbidden not the speaking of tongues in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Anyway, I wanted to go through this, just a teaching. I just want to go through the book of Acts and explain what it is, okay? But first, I want to read something to you here from, let me look at it. This I'm using eSword, so it's pretty quick and it's pretty nice. Listen to this. This is the Apostle Paul speaking in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1. And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. Now, that's what most churches have, an excellent speech, okay, but no power, a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. Verse 2, for I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Okay, now that's one that's highly accepted and quoted in those denominations. And it's good. And that's the gospel. That's number one, right? And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. There's a Baptist preacher that asked me to pray with him about receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he wanted to receive it, but he was convinced he refused that he would have to speak in tongues. He said he wasn't going to do it. Even though it's in the Bible, he seemed to say that speaking in tongues is from the devil, even though it's in the Bible. It's from God. But anyway, he wanted to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And when I read this text to him and asked him what it meant, he said that the demonstration of Spirit and power is when people get saved and their lives change. That's what he said the definition was. So this is the kind of hard-headedness, blindness, arrogance, Phariseeism that we run up against in the leadership in most churches and your denominations. And that's why the Spirit of the Lord moves on and new denominations start, new non-denominational churches start, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. You know, we're not bound by religion. So I've done teachings on that. I could go through that whole thing and talk about it on that topic, but I want to move forward with this one first. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Verse 5. That your faith should not rest stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. So, our faith is in the demonstration of the power of God. The Word of God is confirmed by His Spirit. That's why in Acts chapter 1, let's start with, let's just go through the book of Acts here. I want to go to Acts chapter 1. I'm just going to go through this chapter by chapter and just knock down, shoot down all those godly doctrines that are blocking men from being filled with God's power. So that our faith should rest in the power of God, Paul said. Jesus said also, if you don't believe the things I say, believe for the very works that I do. And Jesus said, greater works than these will you do because I go to the Father. Let's see. I've heard someone twist that into some other meaning too. I forgot it was. That's crazy. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be a witness unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Let me just say about that text. The power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, we have the gifts of the Spirit that comes from the power of the Holy Spirit. But the purpose of all of this is to be a witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. It's to advance the gospel. Okay, and it is true that there are people that are, you know, operating in some other kind of spirit or abuse the power of the Holy Spirit for their own gain, and we know that, okay? But we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. We don't justify the fact that we live a powerless, weak, non Kingdom Advancing Life, because of we don't like the way Benny Hinn acts, or somebody else, whoever you want to pick, you know, to talk about. You don't like the way that the Holy Spirit is working in them, or allegedly working in them, and so you use that as your crutch and excuse to hide from the power of God. So let's just not worry about anybody else. The biggest problem that I've observed in the body of Christ, and I am a pastor, I've been a pastor for 13 years, and actually my ministry is a prophetic ministry. Okay, the Lord leads me and uses me. As an example, when I work with pastors here in the Philippines and in the States, the Lord uses me to advise them of what's God's direction for their ministry and for their church. Now, I could do evangelism, I do preaching and all that, but that's the way the Lord would use me. And that's the job of an office of the prophet in the New Testament, to advise pastors and those in leadership in the church, you know, what's God's direction and what's the vision of God for this ministry, for this church? Is this church going to be an evangelizing church? Is this going to be a missionary sending church? Is it going to be both? Is this going to be, what's this ministry supposed to be doing, you know, and lead them and help them and give them the words of God to do what God called them to do. That's an example. Okay. All the different types of ministries are different. And we have Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. As I mentioned before, there's people on YouTube who believe in total anarchy, which is unbiblical. And then there's who have, you know, the ultimate structure and restriction that the preacher is like a god, where you get into like Roman Catholicism and other denominations too, where it's just all about the denominations, it's all about our traditions, and then, you know, the power of God is made of none effect by your traditions, as Jesus said. You're nullifying the word of God by your traditions. So the balance is in there. You know, we have a balance in there, and the Lord did give us some apostles, some pastors, some teachers and evangelists and prophets for the perfecting of the saints. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. So we have to find a balance in there between the authority of men in the kingdom of God, and every individual is a king and priest before the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's what I'm trying to say to you, okay? And that's what the Lord put me on here for, to try to bring a balance to that, okay? And the biggest thing I observed is there's people, just since I made these videos about grace, I've had a huge attack that I've never had before. And the Lord is, you know, I'm not talking about it that people would say, oh, you've been attacked. No. I'm saying that I observed something common about the people that attack me. They don't really know the word of God, and they're not a preacher. And, you know, they saw some videos, or maybe that's what they were taught in their church. And then in their little world, this is the only option. Just like me, I made videos. That's an example about the Antichrist. We do not know who's the Antichrist. It could be any president of the United States. And at this time, we have a president, and he is a good candidate. If it's not now, which I believe it will be, if it's not, it could be the next president. It could be, you know, the leader of the European Union. It could be the Pope. It could be all these different things it could be, okay? It could be some, you know, the Nephilim come down again. I think it'll be them, the return of the Nephilim. But either way, there are people who will make a comment and say, it's Obama. Don't you know that? You're stupid. You don't know that it's Obama. See, that's the point. You don't know that. We don't know that. That's your opinion. And we can all have our opinions, okay? And we can share them in love and respect without being what they call dogmatic. And if you don't know what dogmatic means, you probably shouldn't be making your comments. It means that, you know, it's your way or the highway is what you're saying. And now some topics, that's true. When we're talking about salvation through Christ, that is only one way. But when you're talking about secondary doctrines, we can have our opinions and we can agree to disagree in love. And that's the problem. When people are commenting and attacking on anybody's video and it's not in love, I already know that, hey, this person is the one with the problem, not the one they're talking to, but them. They have a problem, an ungodly way of doing things, and it's not the right way. It's not in love. All right, brothers and sisters, now that I've been rambling on about that, let's go back to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 2, verse 38, the whole text there. The Holy Spirit came down on them on the day of Pentecost, and then people ask me, you know, is the Holy Spirit, they'll say, you know, well, speaking in tongues is not for everybody. There's the gift of speaking in tongues, and then there's the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the initial evidence of speaking in tongues. Everyone that is a Christian, if you are a born-again Christian, you are eligible to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And I just want to read a verse to you for Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Let's keep talking about Acts chapter 2 here before I I can't check my time because my thing is blocked by this. Okay, it's already been 10 minutes, guys. Let me hustle up through here. Acts chapter 2. They said, if you read that, the whole account there in Acts chapter 2, it says that the people thought they were drunk. Okay. And there was another miracle there. It was not only the people were speaking in tongues and prophesying, people heard it. Everyone had an interpretation also. All the people had a supernatural interpretation, even though they weren't even Christians yet. Now, that was something that was unique to that day. And I don't know of another time. There's no other time recorded in the Bible that that happened, but God can do it again, where you could speak in a foreign language that's unknown to you, and someone else could hear it and get an interpretation in their own language at the same time other people could hear it in their own language. God can still do that and not even be a Christian because, you know, it's for a sign and wonder to the gospel. Okay, so God, when we talk about these rules about the Holy Spirit, you know, it's not written in the Bible about all these rules, what we're saying. This is the way it's happened. But God can do anything, anytime he wants, you know, and moving in miracle signs and wonders. That's why it's a sign and a wonder, because it's not something expected, you know. It's unique. And just like the flood was unique. People before the flood say, well, you know, you're crazy. No, there's never been a flood before. Well, there was that day. On this day, people said, you're crazy. No one's ever spoken some other language they didn't know, and there's never been tongues of fire on people's heads. But it happened that day. Can it happen again? Yes, anytime the Lord wants to, okay? It's up to him. So let's stop limiting and boxing God in our little religious box. Okay, they said that it's like you're drunk. And then Peter said, we're not drunk as you suppose. So see, I just want to say this. I'm not into saying it about, you know, people all have to keep rolling around the floor and all that when they get hit by the Holy Spirit. But Peter and them not only were speaking tongues and prophesying, they were acting as if they were drunk. Okay, and so that's what we see a lot of times in modern churches, in Pentecostal churches, and then other Christians are mocking them and blaspheming the Holy Spirit about it. And then we see that, you know, people were thinking these guys were drunk there on the day of Pentecost. So we need to, you know, take that into consideration when we're mocking what we see people doing under the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, I just wanted to throw that caution. There's lots of other things I could say. Let me skip ahead. Acts chapter 8. And now the people in Samaria had gotten saved. It says, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John. Now before that, in Acts chapter 8, they had already been water baptized. They were already saved and baptized. Okay, some people, I've read even in famous people's books, Baptist preachers, even Billy Graham in his book, and even about the Holy Spirit, and even, of course, Dr. Charles Stanley. They said when you get saved, you're baptized in the Holy Spirit. Okay, but these here in Acts chapter 8, we see that they're already saved and water baptized. And then it says, now when the apostles were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who when they came down, prayed for them, they might receive the Holy Ghost. As he had not yet fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. Okay. And then Simon saw that through the laying on the apostles' hand, the Holy Ghost was given. Okay. He offered money. So Simon saw something, you know, and those old, same old religious people that have no power of God in their life, they've never spoken in tongues, and they're mad, and they don't think no one else should be allowed to because they didn't, because they secretly prayed about it and didn't get an answer, so they want to attack everybody else. In their own frustration, they will say that in this text, it doesn't say anything about them speaking in tongues. Well, it says Simon saw that through the laying on the apostles' hand, the Holy Ghost was given. And it said that the Holy Ghost had not fallen on them as of yet. So Simon saw something that made him say, hey, I would like to have the power to do this too. So something was seen. And I assume and believe, just going in line with the rest of the Word of God, that, you know, that he saw a physical manifestation, which was speaking in tongues and prophesying. Okay. Then those same old religious people will tell you, well, only the apostles can lay hands on you to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now let's look at Acts chapter 9 to answer that question. And there was a certain disciple, Acts chapter 9. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias, he said, behold, I'm here. Okay, and then the Lord told him to go pray. The Lord gave him a word of knowledge. I could do a whole thing on the teaching of the gifts. He told him that there was a man that was Saul of Tarsus in a street called Straight, and go there and lay hands on him. So the Lord gave him a word of knowledge. This guy Ananias didn't know that Saul was there until the Lord told him. And Ananias, in verse 17, and Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, brother Saul. Saul was already saved when he called the Lord Lord on the road to Damascus. Brother Saul, already a Christian, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way, has as thou camest sent me here, that you might receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. So, he laid hands on him. And this guy's not an apostle. He was just a member of the church in Damascus. And God used him to lay hands on Saul to be filled and baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now, Saul had already been saved, but he became filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 19. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul was passing through the upper coast of Ephesus. Oh, yeah, it reminds me. I need to go back to another one. To the upper coast of Ephesus and finding certain disciples. He said unto them, Acts chapter 19, verse 1, I'm on verse 2. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? And they said unto him, we did not so much as heard as whether there be any Holy Ghost. It's like a lot of your modern day people in the denominational churches, you know, like Baptist and Presbyterian and all that. They're like, we've been saved, but there's something you can do with the Holy Ghost. Yes. And he said unto them, unto what were ye baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. Then Paul said, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto people that you should believe on him that would come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. When Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. Now, this is a group of men that were just brothers, because the story of Cornelius and them in Acts chapter 10 and chapter 11, those old denominational people will tell you, well, that was, they spoke in tongues at Cornelius' house because they were Gentiles, and that was the first time the Holy Spirit came on the Gentiles. You know, there's always a twisting and a justification of why they live a powerless, unanointed life. And they, all the mocking they've done of the Holy Spirit, to me, it's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. But I'm not the Lord to judge that. But it is very close as you can get if it's not. It's up to the Lord. Acts chapter 10, let's look at what it says here. Peter went there. Let's see where it is. Because I didn't highlight this text yet already. Now, another thing too, is there's these some people that try to say you need to tarry for 10 days because Jesus told the disciples to tarry for the Holy Spirit and they waited 10 days. And some people even have this crazy idea you need to tarry 10 days. Okay, they tarried because they needed to tarry to the day of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit was released on that day. The Holy Spirit was given to the body of Christ on the day of Pentecost. It is not given again. It's already there. You just need to receive it, okay? It's just like salvation. Salvation was given after the resurrection of Christ, and anybody can receive it. Jesus doesn't get back on the cross. He doesn't re-give the Holy Spirit. He doesn't get new stripes for you to be healed. It's a matter of receiving those covenant things. The Lord made a covenant with us for salvation, for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, for being physically healed, for answering our prayers. He made a covenant with us through his stripes, through his blood, through the giving of the Holy Spirit. It's already been done, brothers and sisters. Let's see. In Acts chapter 10, and when he got to the centurion's house, Cornelius is telling him that he was fasting and he called for him. Let's see. But in every nation, him that feareth and worketh righteousness is accepted with God. Verse 35, verse 36, the word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is the Lord of all. Let's see. But God anointed Jesus Christ with the Holy Ghost and power. I'm sorry, I don't know which verse it's in until I get there. Let's see. He's given them the gospel. When Peter, in verse 44, Acts chapter 10, verse 44, while Peter yet speak these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. How do they know the Holy Ghost was poured on them? For they heard them speaking with tongues and magnifying God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? Okay, so all those, there's like three other times where it says someone received the Holy Ghost, like Paul in Acts chapter 9. Okay. In Samaria, and the ones in Samaria chapter 8, in Acts chapter 8, it doesn't say that they spoke in tongues. It says the Holy Ghost fell on them, and it came on, you know, on Saul of Tarsus, Acts chapter 9. But in this text, it gives us the definition of when the Holy Ghost falls on someone. It says, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speaking with tongues and magnifying God. That's how they knew they had received the Holy Ghost, because they spoke with other tongues and magnified God. Or prophesied is what the other text says. So when you receive the Holy Ghost, brothers and sisters, no matter what some old religious person tells you, if you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, you're going to speak in tongues and magnify God and praise God. And jumping and leaping and praising God, like the man that was lame at the gate called Beautiful there in Acts chapter 3, he jumped and leaped and praised God. And that's the same thing that's going to happen to you if you get the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The people that are telling you that have not received the Holy Spirit. So, of course, they're going to say that. And then there's also a crowd that says, well, people think they're holier than thou because they received the Holy Spirit. No, I don't. Every Christian is eligible. As we read in the first verse, for the promises in Acts chapter 2, verse 39, speaking by the Lord speaking by the mouth of Peter, for the promises unto you and to your children and all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. The Holy Ghost is for you. The Holy Ghost baptism is for you. I've already made a videotape for people to receive it. And I want to pray right now for you. I'm already over 20 minutes. I got more videos to make. It's time for, listen to me. You need the power of the Holy Ghost in your life. Why? It's not a game. It's not a parlor trick. The Lord is going to hold you accountable at the judgment seat of Christ. When you get to heaven, each one of us is going to face that judgment seat of Christ. And the Lord's going to say to you, you know, my power was available for you. And I was going to use you to lay hands on someone that was sick and heal them. And through that person was going to be the next Billy Graham and win 200 million people to me. So you don't know that. You don't know that. The guy that won Billy Graham, okay, was an evangelist who was won by a shoe salesman. Okay? So you don't know who is going to do what for the Lord. You have to offer yourself as a living sacrifice, it says in Romans chapter 7. Therefore, present your body as a living sacrifice, acceptable unto God. So to be acceptable to, as a Christian, we should be open to anything the Lord wants to use us for. And you need to be equipped and empowered. You need to receive power from on high that you can be a witness to the Lord. Listen to me. Everybody that gets saved, that's going to get saved before the rapture of the church, okay, they need a certain thing to happen before they're going to get saved. Either is they need to hear of the Lord's love, they need to hear about hell, they need to see someone healed, they need to be healed, they need to be delivered from drugs, whatever it may be. And all of those things, you don't know what they need. It's like Ananias, that guy we read about in Acts chapter 9. He got a word of knowledge. Hey, a guy named Saul who had been persecuting everybody. I have blinded him. There he is. I want you to go lay hands on him that he can receive his sight, filled with the Holy Spirit. He's going to be a great servant for me. Ananias didn't know any of that in advance. Only by the power of the Holy Spirit, God speaking to him, did he know that he needed to go there. You cannot operate in the gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, without first being baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now, anybody that will tell you different are people that have not been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Okay? But when you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, then you will know, your eyes will be open, and you will have a deep understanding of the Word of God and quickened in your spirit by the power of God, and you will be able to be used by the Master in a hundredfold greater way. It's just like having, as I've said many times, getting saved, you get a wellspring of living water in you, like John chapter 4. But John chapter 7, the Lord said, out of your belly would flow rivers of living water. I'm talking about the, you know, compare the Mississippi River to a little well in your back of your yard. You got a bucket to dip it out. I mean, the well is working. You can drink that. But with a river, you can, you know, you can transform the land. A river changes the landscape. If you were to knock down a dam, it's like a dam in you. People keep talking about the Hoover Dam being knocked down. There's a dam in you. Of your flesh, of the enemy's lies and deceit that's trying to block that river of living water from coming out of you. Now, if you was to knock down a dam and release that water, it changes everything downstream. It's changed. It's renewed. The whole landscape has changed. The power of a river can transform land. Look at the Nile River and how powerful it is to the, you know, to the Egyptian Empire. It was the Nile River that supplied the Egyptian Empire and made it the greatest empire in its time. In the world. Same thing in you, the Jordan River in Israel. You know, that's, you know, you couldn't survive there without that Jordan River. Same thing with you, brothers and sisters. God wants that river of living water, John chapter 7, flowing out of your belly. Now, let's not make any more excuses. Let's not have any more doctrinal discussions. Anybody wants to have a doctrinal discussion? I don't want to have no doctrinal discussion with you. I don't need to have a doctrinal discussion with you. Make videos and make your doctrinal discussion to the people in your clique. This is for the Lord put me on here and gave me a specific assignment. And I'll spell it out more clearly. It's to build the Lord's army. Okay? Now, and don't start talking about the rapture is going to be next week because you know, a 3-2-2 and the skull and bones minus the you know, half the pie of Saturn minus the height of the statue of Nebuchadnezzar's dream and all these calculations about how the Lord's coming back, the rapture is going to be tomorrow. We don't know that. And it's definitely not going to be by all those extra biblical calculations. Those things are only clues to point us to what's going on. You need to, Jesus said, suffice it is, you know, the trouble for today. Don't worry about tomorrow. And don't worry about the past. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day. The Lord wants you to do His will today. Not tomorrow and not yesterday, but today. Right now, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all those other things are going to be added unto you. Now, right now, I speak to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Lord gave me a word while I was praying this a little while ago. And the word, He says, is tell my people I'm on my way, that I'm coming to get them. But in the meantime, this is me talking, in the meantime, we need to get busy. The blessed is the servant who, when the master comes, finds him doing his duty. Matthew chapter 25. Get busy now. Like the five virgins, you know, that had their oil. Lots of people love to mention that one. Need to be ready and be doing all that the Lord has possibly ever called you to do. And I'm trying to help build you so that the army of the Lord can fulfill its call as we get prepared to pass the baton to the nation of Israel. Just as I've mentioned in the video before, the Lord had prompted me this afternoon in John, I believe it's chapter 12, maybe chapter 13, some Greeks came to speak to the Lord, and it says the Lord began to groan in his spirit because it was getting ready for the Last Supper. He was getting ready to go the night in the Garden of Garden of Gethsemane, getting ready to face the crucifixion. And the Greeks were coming to him, and the Lord knew that he first must be rejected by the Israelites first before the Gentiles could come into the kingdom. And he groaned in his spirit. You know, and that's where we are now. There are Jewish people who are inquiring out of being provoked to jealousy for our Lord. But it's not their time yet. There's a remnant of them. There's a little bit of them. But it's not their time yet. Their time is coming. The time of Jacob's trouble, the tribulation period, is at hand. Okay? We need to do all we can do to have everything ready and everything complete, that the age of the Gentiles will be full. We need to press forward. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Stop making excuses. And stop relying on doctrines. I just read to you from the Bible everything you need to know that you can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, just like salvation. You receive it by faith in Jesus' name. You don't wait for the Lord to give it to you. He gave it to the church. If you're a Christian, you're eligible to receive the Holy Spirit. All things that we get from the Lord is by faith. By faith. By faith are you saved. You know, by grace are you saved through faith. Jesus told the woman to touch the hem of his garment. He said, daughter, thy faith has healed thee. Everywhere, the woman that was from the whatever it is, Phoenician woman, who said, even the dog, you know, the dogs eat the crumb from the master table. Jesus said, woman, great is thy faith. It'll be according to what you believed. He said that over, the Lord said that over and over and over again. It'll be according to your faith as you believe. Believe, and you shall receive. I'm almost at 30 minutes, guys. I'm going to pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I release, Lord, the wisdom and the faith upon your people to come in agreement with me right now for them to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, Lord God, that they can receive power from on high, Lord. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on all those who have the faith to believe and receive right now, Lord, upon your people. I release, Lord God, my faith with their faith, Lord. And I decree right now, Lord, that you would just pour out your Holy Spirit on them, Lord. They would receive it right now in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Father, I give you the praise and the glory. I love you guys. I'm going to try to make some more videos. The Lord's been showing me lots of things. We are definitely there on the edge of eternity, brothers and sisters. It is not a time to keep playing and grinning and laughing all the time. We got to get serious. You know, and like I said, People are just worried about running and chasing after every dream and vision they see. And I post dreams and visions, but I lay out lots of Bible verses. People come to complain to me all the time. Tell more about your vision, not about what's in the Bible. Can you imagine that? That's what's wrong with the people. They don't want the Word of God. They just want to hear men's ideas. I give you the Word of God. Receive it and use the wisdom of the Lord from His Word.